I just want to say the joy that I have is to share this fellowship with my friends, Chaz and George, at George's home today. And I'm Pastor Bob of Word Alive Fellowship. And my friends are, of course, with me in the ministry. I've known George 25 years, and our ministry started 25 years ago. And I know Chaz since the mid-2000s, and these brothers are just such a big help today. Before I share, I do want to pause to pray for a moment and to ask you, Father, according to the riches of your glory, that you would strengthen us with the power of your Spirit in the inner man, the inner woman, the inner boy or girl, that you, Father God, would cause the presence of the Lord Jesus to so be a home in our hearts through the recognition of your faithfulness, that we would be so strengthened with all power according to your glorious might, that we would just have all power in the realm of understanding your ways and your thoughts, which are in the Anointed One Jesus, so far above our earthly pattern of thinking, but yet in the mind of the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, we're able to look down from the heavenly places, because that's where you, Jesus, are, exalted at the right hand of the Father, far above all rule, authority, power, and dominion. So thank you, Father God, that we're able to rejoice in you this day, encouraged in heart as we're knit together in love, strengthened, Father God, by your grace in the realm of every understanding of what we have got in Jesus, along with the rest of humanity, because everybody has the same position in Jesus, the divine representative of the Father on the earth, but also at the same time, the human representative of everybody else, every man, woman, boy, and girl on the earth. So thank you, Father, for Jesus, because we're recalling the scripture that Paul the Apostle wrote to Timothy about, 1 Timothy 2:5, that there's one God and one mediator who is on the one hand of God and he's on the other hand of humans, talking about the representative man, the mediator, the Anointed One, Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom on behalf of all people, the testimony given at just the right time. So, Father God, let me give testimony today about you, Lord Jesus, the living Word. Let us understand your way of life that we can tap into on a constant basis in the new covenant of the Spirit, being governed by the law of the Spirit of your life in and through us, Father God. Thank you for giving us grace this day that we may understand your ways. It is our prayer that we understand your thoughts, that we understand Scripture and treat the Bible as a whole in the context of the secret of God, Colossians 2:2, the mysterion of God, the secret of God, namely the Anointed One, Christos, the one who's anointed, the King, the Prophet, the Priest, the one of whom the Scripture speaks, in whom are hid all the treasures of the wisdom and knowledge. So, Father God, give us grace today and open up the Scriptures to us so that we may feed on the living bread, that we may drink of the living water, that we may focus on you, Jesus, the light of the world, that we may abide on you, the true vine, that we may hear your voice, Good Shepherd. Let us enter into an awareness of your presence. In Jesus' name I ask. Amen. In this series of videos, I've not only begun to give my testimony, but to also to relate scriptures in connection with my experiences that cause me to read parts of the Bible and to feel like I understand what this is saying, because I've had an experience with God that the apostle is testifying to having with God, or the prophet is testifying to having with God. So the name of our fellowship is The Word Alive, because it is our prayer at Word Alive that everybody experience, everybody in our fellowship, everybody that gets to hear a video, everybody that gets to watch a video, etc., that all of us would be able to experience the mind of the Spirit. Because Paul says to the Romans, the mind of the Spirit is life and peace, and we want to experience that life and peace. We want to experience His life and His peace. And we want to experience it by partaking of those thoughts, which the Apostle tells the Corinthians are spiritual words that express spiritual thoughts. And we can feed on these thoughts. I was recalling this driving over here earlier this morning about how it says of ancient Israel in 1 Corinthians 10:3, there's a statement made about ancient Israel. They all ate the same spiritual food. They all drank the same spiritual drink. They drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them. And that rock was the Christos. That's the Greek for the Hebrew Mashiach, which is in Hebrew, the anointed one. In Greek, the anointed one. And who is anointed? The king, the priest, the prophet. And Jesus fulfills all these roles. So getting revelation of him as king, getting revelation of him as priest, getting revelation of him as prophet, as the word of God, as the message and the communicator of the Father's message to us. Jesus is the only one who's ever seen the Father. John 6:46. No one's seen the Father except me. I've seen the Father, like Jesus telling us, I know him. John 1:18. He is the unique God in John 1:18 that no one is. You know, remember how it's put, if I may take my own translation of Greek to English for John 1:18, given the fact that the Greek of the Gospel of John is real simple Greek, and in Bible college I was able to learn at least simple Greek. But in John 1:18, no one has ever seen God ever. But the unique, monogenes, the unique or one of a kind, right? The unique God. The man who's on the bosom of the Father, in other words, lives in closest intimacy with the Father, he's made him known. And why can he make him known? Because he's actually seen the Father. He knows the invisible essence of God by being able in the Spirit to see him in a way that nobody else has ever been able to see him. Because in order to see him, God had to appear in the Garden of Eden, walking with Adam and Eve, appear in the human likeness. And indeed, Jesus is that human likeness of the Father. And he was presenting himself to Adam and Eve as the image of the Father because he took on the form, the same form that Numbers 12:8 speaks of, when Moses gets a chance to see the form of the Lord. You could translate that, the appearance of the Lord. In other words, the form that Jesus takes is that role of being the image of the invisible Father. He's in the likeness of a human all through the time that God is revealing himself to people like Adam and Eve, walking and talking with them in the garden, appearing later to Abraham, appearing later to Isaac, appearing later to Jacob, appearing later to Moses and to King David. And all of these biblical prophets, they got a chance to encounter God through the Son of God representing the invisible Father to them in the human likeness that later on is fulfilled in Jesus, who in John 1:14 is the Word of God that became human and pitched his tent among us as in the tabernacle. And we have gazed on his glory, the glory of the unique man from the Father, full of grace and full of truth. And so to talk today about my take on the Word of God, namely Jesus, and how he is the key to tie the whole Bible together in terms of understanding the revelation that Adam and Eve got of him later when Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses and King David, all the biblical prophets, the revelation that they got of the Son of God, the image of the invisible Father, and how that culminates in the Word becoming human and living among us, and the testimony of the apostles who make claims like the Apostle Peter in 2 Peter 1:16, where he says, we didn't follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord Jesus the Messiah, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when the majestic voice spoke to him from heaven. And the Apostle Peter says, we apostles were with him on the sacred mountain, and we heard this voice when the majestic glory said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. We ourselves heard this voice when we were with him on the sacred mountain, and we have the word of the biblical prophets confirmed beyond doubt. And you'd do well to pay attention to the word of the prophets as paying attention to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture ever came about by the prophet's own interpretation. For no prophecy ever had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So it is our prayer this day, Lord, that you would teach us by the same Spirit that inspired the prophets to speak their testimony when they had an encounter with you, living God, in the person of Jesus, even if that is the Son of God prefiguring the humanity of Jesus. I'm asking, Father God, that you would do according to your power at work within us today to open the eyes of our hearts so that we can understand the riches of the glory of our inheritance as a co-heir with the Messiah himself, and to experience, Lord, an understanding of our relationship with you, Father, because of Jesus, whom you've given to all of us in the world to be our high priest and our representative and our mediator. Thank you, Father God, for helping us in opening up the scriptures to us. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. In the interest of treating the Bible as a whole, I'm going to borrow an outline from Paul's letter to the Galatians. Because what Paul does in the letter to the Galatians is he talks about three major covenants. And I see these covenants tie the Bible together. The covenant with Abraham, the covenant that's mediated through Moses, and the covenant that's mediated through Jesus. And Jesus is the mediator of the new covenant. And the new covenant is different in function than the earlier covenant through Moses. And then both of those covenants are different than the one that is picked up on in Galatians 3:15 and following, which is the first covenant that we'll bring out today, which is the covenant with Abraham. Because I'd like to do it in the same order that Paul comments on the covenants in, that is to start with Abraham and then go to Moses and then go to Jesus. So let's start with Galatians 3:15. And I'm essentially taking this from the NIV. But at times I'll just tweak the NIV with a very simple Greek that I do understand from Bible college, but I'm able to at least tweak the NIV at points when the Greek is needing to be brought out more clearly than what the NIV can provide. But just for starters, I'm going to borrow from Galatians 3 and begin at verse 15. Brothers and sisters, I want to give you an example from everyday life. Just as no one can add to or set aside a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. The Greek word is sperma. So it's the idea of the sperm that causes that connection with that part of the woman to create a child. So this is the idea of the sperma. In Galatians 3:16, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his sperma, his seed. The scripture doesn't say, and to seeds or sperms, but to your seed or to your sperm, who is one person, Christos, he's the anointed one. And then he goes on into verse 17 to say that the law covenant was not the covenant in force at the time of God's revelation to Abraham. So Galatians 3:17 is saying that the law came 430 years later than the covenant with Abraham. And because it came 430 years later, it cannot set aside the covenant promise that was made to Abraham. And why can't it set it aside? Because once a covenant is duly established, nothing can happen to change the terms of the covenant. Nothing can be happening to add conditions to it or to take anything away from it. It's a done deal. Well, that's what he's saying in Galatians 3:17. You know, what I mean is that the law, which came 430 years later than Abraham, cannot set aside the covenant previously established with Abraham and thus do away with the promise made to Abraham. And then he says in Galatians 3:18, for if the inheritance, and that is the covenant that we're talking about now, Genesis 15:7 to the end of the chapter, a covenant promising the inheritance to Abraham and to his seed, ultimately that being the anointed one, but in the anointed one, humanity finds his or her identity by an explanation of the gospel that in this series of videos, we look forward by the grace of God to hearing more about. But for the moment, Galatians 3:18, if the inheritance depends on the law of Moses being fulfilled by us, then that would mean that the inheritance is no longer based on a covenant promise that happened 430 years before the covenant of Moses' laws came to the people. So again, in Galatians 3:18, if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on a promise. But God in his grace gave the inheritance covenant to Abraham through a promise. Now, before we go on to the next verse, which is Galatians 3:19, before we go on to Paul introducing the next covenant of the law, the one that Moses is mediator of, before we go to the covenant of law, let's say a word more about the promise of the inheritance. Just a word about it, that the inheritance is talking about land. As we said earlier, Genesis 15:7 to the end of the chapter talks about a promise to Abraham and to his sperm that the land from the modern territory of Israel all the way to the Euphrates River, and specific countries are mentioned as being like the land of the Kenite and the land of the Kenizzite and the land of the Hittite and the land of the Amorite and the land of the Canaanite and the land of the Jebusite. In other words, specific countries are mentioned, but all part of this territory. From the modern land of Israel with its western border on the Mediterranean Sea all the way to the east, all the way to the Euphrates River, which is like the territory of modern Iraq, that this whole area of the Middle East is going to be in the covenant promise of the inheritance, the land that God is giving to the sperm of Abraham. And ultimately, that's going to include everybody being an heir to that covenant promise of that inheritance. It's just that I just wanted to say before we go into the covenant of law, that this land that is described, Genesis 15:7 to the end of the chapter, and specific countries are mentioned within that land, and the general territory from the western border of modern Israel, the Mediterranean Sea, all the way east to the Euphrates River, like modern Iraq, this whole area of the Middle East, is this land that is promised as the inheritance given to the children of God, those that are in the family of God, that are promised the property that the Father gives to the children, the land that would be their home, the territory with the, where they would live. It's given to the children. Well, it would take a whole message to talk about Malachi 2:10 that says, in the form of a question, do we not all have one Father? And another question, did not one God create us? The whole teaching about how we are all children of God, just because God is our creator, the relationship that God has with all of us because we are his children, as in Isaiah 64:8. I like that particular verse, but Isaiah 64:8, You are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We're all the work of your hand. Even way back, if I remind myself that what I'm doing is talking momentarily about the significance of the covenant of the inheritance in Galatians 3:18, what the inheritance is, it's the land that God promised to his children, saying a moment of testimony about who the children are. Well, ultimately, it's everybody, because in Malachi 2:10, all of the people that God created are all his children. And there's more to be said about that in a future video. I'll need to talk about all the scriptures that complement Isaiah 64:8, that you are our Father, we're the clay, you're the potter, we're all the work of your hand. But for the moment, I just want to say that God gives the inheritance to his children. And that means that in Psalm 115, verse 16, there is a significant statement where I'm reading in Psalm 115, verse 16, the highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he has given to Adam. Adam in the Hebrew can be translated humanity. And it is translated that way in Genesis 1:26. Let us make Adam, humanity, in our image and our likeness. Well, in Psalm 115, verse 16, the highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he's given to humanity. In other words, ultimately, the earth is the inheritance. The word for earth or land, eretz, is the fourth most common word in the Hebrew Bible. The word for land or earth, eretz, in the Hebrew Bible. Fourth most common word in the Jewish Bible. And that is the land in Genesis 15, 7 and following, that's part of a covenant promise to Abraham. That is the earth that is mentioned also to Adam in Genesis, as well as Psalm 115, verse 16, the highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth is given to Adam, which is humanity. In other words, this is all part of what we're talking about with the inheritance. So because I'm treating the Bible as a whole, looking at the major covenants that tie the Bible together, Abraham, Moses, and Jesus, then I'm declaring my excitement in the realization that the earth is our home. Because in the Lord's Prayer, the earth is our inheritance, it's our home. Because in the Lord's Prayer, we remember Jesus teaching his disciples to pray, our Father, including everybody in Jesus' audience, as being included, because not only did he tell his 12 disciples, our Father, what ends up being the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse 9, but there were thousands of people in the audience, because this is the Sermon on the Mount, and when he was on the Mount, it said in Matthew 5:2 that the crowds came to Jesus, the crowds, plural, came to Jesus. This wasn't just his 12 disciples that he was saying are children of God by making mention of our Father at the beginning of the prayer. This is thousands of Jewish people that have come to him on the mountain where he's teaching not only the 12, but also the thousands, but they're all included when he says our Father at the beginning of the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6:9. So that means they're all entitled to the inheritance, and they will all get the inheritance. And the inheritance is the land, it's the earth that is going to be in view in the Lord's Prayer when Jesus goes on to say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So Jesus is declaring a commitment to the covenant with Abraham that the children of God would receive the inheritance on earth as home. Because God would make the earth like heaven so that we could experience in the promised land, that geographical region on the planet from modern Israel east to the Euphrates River, that area would be in Habakkuk 2:14, the earth or the land that's filled with the knowledge of God's glory. That in Isaiah 11:9, it'd be that land that's filled with the knowledge of God. In other words, that God would just make the kingdom of heaven be manifest on the earth. And this covenant promise of the inheritance means in Romans 8, 17, ultimately we're all co-heirs with the Messiah because he became a member of the human race. John 1, 14, the Word of God became flesh, that is human. And in doing so, he became, as it says in 1 Timothy 2, 5, the mediator who is himself human and represents humanity, the anointed one, Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom on behalf of all people, the testimony given at just the right time. But at the same time, he is representing God because his spirit never had a beginning and will never have an end, because John 1, 1, in the beginning of time at creation, when all things were created at the beginning of time, he was already living. In the beginning of time, the Word was already living. And the Word was already living in fellowship with God the Father. And he was already existing in the divine nature of never having a beginning or end in his spiritual essence. So he is unique. He is the God-man. 2:5. There's one God and one mediator who's of God and of Adam. He's of humanity. The man, the anointed man, Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom on behalf of all people, the testimony given at just the right time. So, saying all this about Jesus being human and him representing all humanity, how Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, 20, that Jesus is the first to rise from the dead, the first fruits of those that have fallen asleep. For it goes on to say in 1 Corinthians 15, now 21, for since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead people also comes through a man. Goes on to the next verse, 1 Corinthians 15, 22. For as in Adam all die, as in the anointed man who takes the role of humanity to replace the sinner representative of the race, now we're looking at the saint that's the representative of the same race. Reviewing 1 Corinthians 15, 22, as in Adam all die, so in Christos, the anointed man, all will be made alive. Why will they be made alive? Because they'll be made alive to receive their inheritance, to receive their home on this earth, which is in the kingdom of God. Just like it is in heaven to have earth be filled with the knowledge of his glory, as Habakkuk saw in his vision, as Isaiah saw in his vision, that the earth would be filled with the knowledge of God. And what happens in John 17, 3, when people know the only true God, and they know Jesus who's anointed, whom the Father sent forth, what happens when they know God like this? Then they experience Zoe Ionios, traditionally translated eternal life. But in this context, it's eternal life on earth. It's experiencing our inheritance, our home. It's experiencing the kingdom on earth, as in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, your kingdom come on earth, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And this is the promise that was given to Abraham and to his sperma, the anointed one, that would include humanity in his humanity, because he's representative. He's the mediator. He's of God, he's of humanity. So we are represented by him at the right hand of the Father, even as we speak this day. Jesus is exalted at the right hand of the Father, and he is the Adam, that is the humanity that is perfect, that allows us to understand Ephesians 1, 4, that we were chosen in the anointed man to be holy and blameless in the Father's sight before the creation of the world in love. We were predestined to be adopted as his children through Jesus, who's anointed unto himself according to his pleasure and will, so that all of the children, and I'm saying we're all his children. Do we not all have one Father? Did not one God create us? The answer to Malachi's questions are both yes. We do have one Father, and we do have one Creator. And he made us in the image of Elohim, which is the word for God. He made us in that image. Well, Jesus is the image of God. He's the visibility of the Father in humankind. So therefore, we find our identification in Jesus, not with the first Adam, who died on the cross for his sin in the person of his representative along with the rest of the human race. But we find our identity in the last Adam, the one who was raised from the dead people, that is righteous on behalf of all of us, so that we would all in the eyes of God be presentable to the Father in a righteous condition, to be able to receive our inheritance in the righteous condition of his righteousness on our behalf. So we do get the inheritance, all of us get the inheritance, and that's guaranteed for a future day when all will be made alive, just like Isaiah 26:19. I like the verse which prophesies the resurrection, and even the King James Bible brings out the thought, your dead people will live, together with my dead body they will arise. To me, this is a prophecy of Jesus' own bodily resurrection on behalf of the people that had only destiny on their own account to be experiencing the wages of death, because everybody had a relationship with the sin, because the wages of the sin is death, Romans 6:23. But Jesus, in his grace, took the identity of humanity in his own humanity to the cross and crucified the old identity and buried the old identity. And on the sign of Jesus' resurrection, he represents in this gift of God, which in Romans 6:23 says, the gift of God is this Zoe Ionios, is this eternal life on earth. In other words, it's our inheritance in the home on this earth that's guaranteed by the covenant promise to Abraham, that we're all going to get it, because even though in Adam all die, in the anointed one all will in the future on the last day be made alive when Jesus says, I'll raise you up on the last day, John 6:40. Well, it's a guarantee of the promise of the covenant with Abraham. It's a done deal. It's going to happen in the future. But the degree to which we can experience it present tense is concerning the covenants that come after Abraham. Because right now the covenant with Abraham is just securing the guarantee for the future resurrection, where we will rise to live in the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And there will be immortality in that day, and that's what 2 Timothy is referring to. But before I get to 2 Timothy, I remember that I didn't finish Isaiah 26:19. I got excited about Jesus being the one whose dead body would rise along with the rest of us. So before I go to my 2 Timothy passage, let me just say one more thing about Isaiah 26:19. Your dead will live, in the King James, together with my dead body, as if Jesus is being prophesied about his own bodily resurrection, together with my dead body, they will arise. And then in the NIV, it says at the end of Isaiah 26:19, at the end, the NIV says at the end of Isaiah 26:19, the earth will give birth to her dead people. And we were originally created from the earth when in Genesis 2:7, God formed Adam out of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Well, that is what's going to happen again in the end of Isaiah 26:19. The NIV says the earth will give birth to her dead people. God's gonna do it again. He's going to cause us to be truly born again, because we're going to get the physical body with the formation that he made us out of the dust of the earth. He'll do it again for the dead people, so that he'll breathe again into our nostrils the breath of life, like he did at the first creation in Genesis 2:7. He'll do it again. He'll breathe the breath of life into us, and we'll all become a living soul again. We'll all be a living human again to have our inheritance in the kingdom on the earth with Jesus, whose inheritance is on the earth, because he is of the tribe of Judah, and he's got inheritance property that's promised to him specifically in Genesis 15 to associate with the land that is given to the tribe of Judah. In other words, Jesus is from the tribe of Judah. And it says in Zechariah 2:12 that he gets to inherit, based on the fact that it says the Lord will receive his portion of inheritance in the Holy Land to identify with the tribe of Judah. You know, Zechariah 2:12, the Lord says, I will receive my portion of land in association with the tribe of Judah. I'll receive this portion of land concerning my inheritance in the Holy Land. He's talking about the Holy Land in Zechariah 2:12. The Lord says, I'll receive my portion of my inheritance in the Holy Land. Well, Jesus is from the tribe of Judah. So he's there in the kingdom with us. Why is he in the kingdom? Why is Jesus as a human being in the kingdom with us? Since the inheritance is given to Adam, humanity. Because Jesus joined the human race. When in John 1:14, the Word became flesh, and as a human is pictured among us. But on the side of resurrection, Jesus retains his humanity as well as his divinity. Since Paul wrote this to Timothy, 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God, present tense, there is one mediator. And he presently is of God, and he presently is of humanity. Presently the man who's anointed king. So why will Jesus be in the kingdom on the earth with us? Why will Jesus be included in his humanity among us on this earth? Because he is the king. He is the head of the body. He is the living stone. He is the true vine. In other words, he is the one that is the true Adam, the true representative, but he is in Psalm 22 prefigured in verse 22. I mean, Psalm 22, verse 22, you know, according to the interpretation of the writer of Hebrews about the Messiah in Psalm 22, verse 22, it says, I will declare your name to my brothers and sisters. In the presence of the congregation, I will sing your praises with my brothers and sisters. So Jesus is pictured as praising God as a member of the congregation. In the kingdom, Jesus is in the assembly praising the Father, declaring the Father's name to the brothers and sisters in the congregation, singing praises along with the rest of the singers. It's beautiful. We are co-heirs with Adam, the humanity that gets the earth as his inheritance. And Jesus is ultimately the heir, but we're all included in him in 1 Corinthians 1:30. By God's doing, you are all included in the anointed one, Jesus. He, therefore, is your wisdom and your righteousness. He, therefore, is your holiness and your redemption. In other words, it's the gift of God. In John 3:16, Jesus is the gift of God that the Father's already given to the world. He is the gift, just like in Romans 6:23. He is the gift of God. And on the basis of who he is, then we get the eternal life on earth that is in the anointed Jesus, who is our Lord. I'm just expressing that I'm excited about this good news. And yet, I said that there was a 2 Timothy verse that I wanted to get to after I had completed the Isaiah 26:19 about your dead people will live together with my dead body. They will arise. And at the end of the verse, the NIV says, the earth will give birth to her dead people. And after making that comment, I said that there was a 2 Timothy verse that I wanted to mention. And I'll just mention it real quick in 2 Timothy 1, starting at 9, that this grace was given to us in the anointed Jesus before the beginning of time. And this grace has been revealed by the appearing of the anointed Jesus, our Savior, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality. So it's not only spiritual life, but it's also the guarantee of immortality, resurrection in the body, along with Jesus, our representative who resurrected in the body. So altogether, 2 Timothy 1:9, this grace was given us in the anointed Jesus before the beginning of time, but this grace has now been revealed by the appearing of our anointed Savior, Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the good news. And Paul goes on to say, of this good news, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I'm telling you the truth, I'm not lying. And a teacher of the nations in faithfulness and truthfulness. The apostle Paul had a vision of how Jesus represents the human race and compares the first Adam to the last Adam in Romans 5. And in Romans 5, 12 to the end of the chapter, the comparison is between the one representative of humanity's sin and the other representative of humanity's righteousness, and how Jesus went to the cross to get rid of humanity's sin, but Jesus resurrected on the basis of his own righteousness to stamp the human race righteous as if he had just created us in Genesis 1, 26 in the image of himself, which is Jesus, the image of the Father. He had created us in the Messiah, Jesus. That's where in 2 Timothy 1, 9 it says we were given this grace in Messiah Jesus before the beginning of time. It's like God already had in mind our being represented by Jesus, who is the image of God, so that we would be created in that image, namely Jesus, in Genesis 1, 26, as far as God's view of humanity. And that's why it can say in Genesis 1, 28, the man and woman are told by God, you are blessed and fill the world with your offspring because I want this world filled with your offspring. I want the planet to be populated. I want you to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth so that you can receive your inheritance, your home being the earth, so you can be co-heirs with the Messiah, the fullness of Adam, who is also of God in the spirit, but in humanity. He's one of us because he became part of the human race. John 1:14, the word became flesh. And on the side of his resurrection, he retains his glorified flesh or his glorified humanity, of which we're co-heirs in Romans 8:17. But all of that, I wanted to say before I went on to the next Galatians verse. Because remember I said in Galatians 3, 15 to 18, there's a statement about the covenant with Abraham. Remember that one? And I said, I want to say a little bit about the inheritance before I go on to the law of Moses. Well, I found myself hanging out on the covenant of the inheritance and not yet getting to the law of Moses. So what I'll do is do the law of Moses, which is going to pick up when I get to it in Galatians 3, 19, when he asked the question, what then was the purpose of the law? You know, which is the next covenant, the one that was 430 years after Abraham. He's going to address that when he gets to Galatians 3, 19. What then was the purpose of the law? And he's going to tackle that. And then later, he's going to tackle the new covenant mediated through Jesus. And he's going to do it in Galatians 3, 19, talking about the law. And then he's going to go all the way to chapter 4, verse 7, and end it with the new covenant mediated by Jesus. He's going to treat the Bible as a whole by looking at these three major covenants, the Abraham covenant, the Moses covenant that's mediated through Moses, the one mediated through Jesus, the new covenant. I mean, he's using these covenants as a way to treat the Bible as a whole, and I'm finding this outline of the Bible as a whole in the Galatian letter. And when I said Galatians 3, 15 to 18 about the covenant with Abraham, I thought, okay, well, I'll start there, and the next thing I'll do is go to the covenant with Moses and the covenant with Jesus, thinking that I would, you know, survey all of that today, thinking I would survey, you know, Galatians 3:15 all the way to chapter 4:7. It would be a great survey of the whole Bible. We could treat the whole Bible as a whole today. You know, just use Galatians 3:15 to 4:7 as an outline, and it'll get all the covenants in there, covenant with Abraham, Moses, and Jesus. And then I said to myself, I got to say something about the inheritance. Well, I ended up hanging out on that covenant with Abraham. And it's going to have to be another video that picks up on the covenant with the law. And it's going to have to be another video that picks up with the covenant of Jesus being mediator, the new one. But for the moment, declaring my contentment today with just hanging out with the first covenant mentioned in Galatians 3, starting at 15, the one with Abraham, and that's about the inheritance. And having said something about that today, I'm just going to review my statement, which is really borrowed from the Apostle Paul, writing to the Galatian congregation, which was nearly 2,000 years ago, Galatians 3, I'm going to say it again, Galatians 3, 15 to 18. Galatians 3, 15 to 18. Brothers and sisters, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can add to or set aside a human covenant that's been duly established, so it is in this case. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed, literally his sperma. The scripture doesn't say into seeds or into spermas, but into your seed, to your sperma, who is one person, who is the anointed one, Christos. What I mean is that the law, which came 430 years later, does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then the inheritance no longer depends on a promise. But in the grace of God, God gave the inheritance to Abraham through a promise. Next verse, Galatians 3:19, raises this profound question. What then was the purpose of the law? It was added to create violations until the sperma, that singular seed, would come, namely the Messiah. Until the Messiah would come later in history and transition the people from a covenant that put a moral standard on them, which they couldn't keep. So it ended up being a law that came in to multiply the transgression or to create violation by giving them a standard that they couldn't keep. And Jesus came later to redeem them from the curse of the law, putting a standard on them that they couldn't keep. And then the wages of sin would be death, and Messiah coming to bear that curse of the covenant on the cross and die their death to institute the new covenant on the side of his resurrection and all that stuff. Those covenants that Paul deals with in Galatians 3:19 and following, the covenants mediated through the law of Moses and then later the new one mediated through Jesus, I'll have to talk about those covenants in the later videos.